just across the sea, on this world so round. The sun is shining hot right now. And even though the winter still surrounds this town, I can still feel that sun somehow. And I know that my sun will shine just as sure as this world can spin. I can hold on fine, yeah, it's almost time for that sun to come round again. So I'll walk beside the sea on this frozen ground, where there once was a warm weather crowd. And even though that summer is a long time gone, I can still feel that sun somehow. And I know that my sun will shine just as sure as this world can spin. I can hold on fine, yeah, it's almost time for that sun to come round again. When your love grows cold and your heart goes dark, and the blame seems to fall on you, look how seasons do change, and don't think it's so strange, but how we feel goes in circles too. And just know that your sun will shine just as sure as this world can spin. We can hold on fine, yeah, it's almost time for that sun to come round again. You can hold on fine, hey, it's almost time for that sun to come round again.
One of my regular greetings, I don't know why I do this, but I always ask, hey, what's going on? That's what I always seem to ask. And I went into the guitar store the other day and asked that question, hey, what's going on? You know, I used to love taking my dad into the guitar store because it was always, you know, you just wait to see what's going to happen. He wasn't Archie Bunker, but he hadn't been around a whole lot of creative people in his life. Not like I run into every week. With my friends that are musicians and artists, and it's always fun, you know. I'd go in there, and you know, there'd be somebody who'd be different than me, and my dad would always look them up and down, and every now and then he had something really special to say. I told you before that there was one time I had dad in the guitar store, and there was a musician friend of mine in there who I think he had 70 piercings in his head. It's like all around his ears and nose and lips and eyebrows and all this stuff. And my dad's just looking at him. Okay, I'm talking to him. We're talking. And in fact, when the guy moved, he rattled. Okay. Anyhow, he had so many piercings. Anyhow, my dad keeps looking at him. And he goes, you know what, son? He says, you remind me of the fish that got away. You know, the one with the lure in his mouth still. And we all cracked up. He always had something like that. And whenever I'd bring him in, those guys would enjoy to find out what the old man was going to say, you know. Well, I was in there the other day. I'm the old man now. And I go in, I give him my regular question. Hey, what's going on? And this one musician friend of mine turned around and said, Tommy, we're bumming. And so he went on to tell me how depressed he was and why he was struggling. But that's a question we can, you know, we can all ask one another, because depression's a normal thing of life in a broken world, and we're broken people, and things get out of whack, and or sometimes we get out of the way, you know, out of the proper way to go, and because of that, we suffer emotionally and spiritually because of that. So it's an interesting book that I read years ago by Benjamin Rush, you know, one of the founding fathers. He was the doctor that bled George Washington to death, okay? So, you know, they were just finding some stuff out then. But this one book that he wrote, it was amazing. He was the father of psychiatry, Dr. Rush was. And he had a book that he wrote, Diseases of the Mind. And in that book, he comes to the conclusion that those of us who are mentally ill or emotionally ill really struggle in the fall and winter because of light deprivation, he would say. And I've come to agree with him. His observations were right back, you know, 250 years ago. He was on the money. And we can see it now in the depths of winter here in this place. And you notice by the song I started with that equates our weather right now to our emotions. Some of us can kind of seem crusty and frozen over at a moment like this. So depression is a normal part of life. And, you know, when you try to diagnose it, you know, there's a lot of signs that you could have depression, even clinical depression, stuff like this. You can have, like, your motivation is drained. You have just no desire to do anything. That's a sign. So is when you're talking to people that you love and all you want is for the conversation to get over with so you can go and be by yourself again, that's depression. You have no desire to participate in stuff that you've loved. You're in a daze when you start thinking about your future or plans. You're just kind of in a daze about all of that. Another thing that depression does is it also blinds us to our blessings. All of a sudden, everything becomes negative. Now, listen, this happens to everybody. I'm reading a book this week of the wife of the great English preacher Charles Spurgeon. He was called the Prince of Preachers. He began his pastorate at the Metropolitan Tabernacle in London in the 1850s when he was 19 years old. And just the breadth of work that this guy produced was amazing. And he was just an incredible communicator and a great Bible teacher. He was a wonderful man. But he had a depressive disorder. And he was so often in the absolute depths of depression. And if it wasn't for his sweet wife, Susie, he would have never made it through. She understood him and she helped him through those dark, dark times of depression. It happened to Martin Luther, one of the great reformers, and many other Christians. And what's really sad is so many try to hide the fact that they struggle. So many think that they have to be super Christians. And they ask questions like, you know, how can this happen to me? I thought I was a stronger Christian than this. I must not be very, you know, spiritual. What's wrong with me? And all, but in all reality, it's just a normal part of life. And, you know, diagnosing it is pretty simple. So if you're struggling with that, let's look at just one particular person in the Old Testament. His name was Elijah, and he went through this terrible time of depression. And this is 1 Kings chapter 19. And there is a great confrontation that Elijah has with the prophets of Baal and with the evil king of Israel at the time, Ahab, and his wife Jezebel. Now there's a name, because you know, man, when your name becomes a condition, she is pretty wicked lady, and there's a lot to be told about her in the book of 1 Kings toward the end of it. Kind of strange people. But anyhow, Elijah confronts the prophets of Baal. He has a tremendous victory, and then he gets this letter. Now Ahab, the king, told Jezebel everything Elijah had done and how he had killed the prophets with the sword. By the way, when you read the Old Testament, get ready, because it tells it just the way it is. Doesn't clean it up, doesn't try to make it sound any different than what it actually was. This is history we're reading here. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, May the gods deal with me ever so severely if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like one of them. Now, the great prophet Elijah that had confronted the entire nation of Israel gets this message from this lady. Now, she was the queen. It says in verse 3, Elijah was afraid and he ran for his life. And when he came to Bathsheba in Judah, he left his servant there while he himself went a day's journey into the desert. He came to a broom tree, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. He said, I've had enough, Lord. Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under the tree and fell asleep. You know what that's called? Depression. He had been through so much. The pressure had been on. The battles had been great. And you know, even when you go through a time of tremendously good things, you can fall into depression after that. There's just this ebb and flow in our lives. Well, you know, he'd really been through it. And then he gets threatened by the queen and he is afraid and he runs away. And God knew exactly what he needed. He fell asleep, and get this, at once an angel touched him and said, get up and eat. And he looked around, and there by his head was a cake of bread baking on hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you. And he got up and ate and drank, and strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night. All right. One of the most important things you can do when you're going through depression is to realize something very important. Now, get this, it's very important. We are not just spiritual beings. We're physical beings. And we have to treat our bodies and our spirits, our souls, our mental state and our emotions very carefully and take care of ourselves, or things can go sideways. And here, the prophet, he needed something, a couple of things very badly. He needed rest and he needed food. He didn't even know what he needed. He just ran away and crashes under this tree, and the Lord lets him sleep, and the Lord has an angel wake him up and tell him to eat. And there's, you know, water and bread, you know, that's baking, and boy, nothing like fresh baked bread anyhow. So he eats. He does this a couple of times through this however long time he slept. But you know, if you're going through depression, you need food and you need rest. You need exercise too. But Elijah here had been getting a bunch. He had run for a couple of days and he was about to run for 40 more days here. So he had plenty of exercise, but those things. And it's very important, because if you don't take care of your body and your mind and your spirit properly, you're gonna struggle. You're gonna have trouble. Did you ever see it? There was a commercial some years ago. It was a radio commercial. It was about air conditioning. And it said, summertime is very difficult because it gets really hot, and it can really affect your relationships. In fact, let's look at a marriage when it's 70 degrees. And the man says, oh, I love you. And she says, oh, you're my Prince Charming. And, oh, you're just the most wonderful woman in the world. And then it says, oh, let's turn it up to 80. And he goes, yeah, you're okay. She says, yeah, you'll do. And then they turned it up to 90. And he says, woman, you're driving me crazy. And she says, the best thing about you is you're biodegradable. What that means is our environment and our condition affects us tremendously. Ever heard the term hangry? I mean, you get on edge and angry because you're hungry. Hangry is what they call it now. What it means is your blood sugar is dropping and you need some food. I mean, we have some things we have to take care of ourselves, to take care of those needs that our bodies have. And it's really, really important. So Elijah had a spiritual problem, but God took care of the physical stuff first so that he could then face the spiritual stuff. So the physical reasons for depression were removed. And then he travels for 40 days and he comes to Mount Horeb, which they called the mountain of God. And he went into a cave and he spent the night in the cave. Verse 9, he came to the cave and spent the night. And the word of the Lord came to him. Get this quote. What are you doing here, Elijah? And he replied, here it comes. I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. And I'm the only one left. Now they're trying to kill me too. And then God gives him an experience, has him go to the mouth of the cave and see a windstorm and lightning and all these things. God continues to speak to him in a still small voice. Elijah, what are you doing here? And he repeats it again. You know, I've been very zealous for the Lord, like the Lord didn't hear it the first time, right? And, you know, nobody else is following you but me. I'm the only one left. Well, when you have a spiritual problem, it's for one of two reasons. Let's just get the first one out of the way, and that is, sometimes we're just involved in the wrong things. The Bible calls that sin, okay? There's a simple quote from the Old Testament where the prophet says, your sins have separated you from God. Now, when we're doing the wrong thing and we know it, now I want you to know something. If you know the Lord, he doesn't leave you, okay? He's not going to leave you. He said this, I'll never leave you. I will never forsake you. And he knows how, you know, how we have this tendency to do the wrong thing. He didn't say, I'll be with you as long as you do the right thing. The Lord is never going to leave you. But we emotionally leave him when we get involved in things that we know are sin and that are wrong. You know, sexually, different addictions, greed, lust, jealousy. I mean, just go on and on with the list. We can go through all seven deadly sins that the church listed back in the 3rd century. But I mean, when we're doing the wrong thing, you know, you're going to feel far away from God. You're going to have a spiritual problem because of that. And the Bible tells us, in fact, John wrote it in his first letter, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. One of the most important things we can do is just tell the truth. You notice the Bible doesn't say to fix you. The Bible says to repent. That means to turn around in your mind and say, Lord, you're right. You're right about this. And what I'm doing here is wrong. And emotionally, you will return to him. It's a very good thing. Did you ever see the skit that Bob Newhart did as a therapist once? I just saw it again on YouTube just recently, where he comes in and he's in his office and a lady comes in and says, you know, Dr. Schwartz or whoever it is, you know, it's been recommended that I come and see you. I have this terrible problem. He says, okay, well, listen, I'm only going to take 5 minutes of your time and I charge $5 for 5 minutes. You can pay cash, check, but I don't make change. Okay. He does this crazy stuff. He says, tell me what your problem is. And she says, well, I have this terrible fear of being buried alive in a box. And he says, have you ever been buried alive in a box? She said, no. He says, okay, I've got a cure. It's two words. She says, should I write this down? He says, you might want to, if you want to. I mean, go ahead. But most people can remember these two simple words. Are you ready? She said, yes. He said, stop it. Okay. And then tried charging her $3 because it had only been 3 minutes. It's a goofy skit. But seriously, if you want to live a happy life, if you want to feel better about yourself, agree with him and stop it, okay? It's pretty simple. In fact, there is this inventory that we should all be taking of ourselves that the psalmist wrote about in Psalm 139. Let me read this to you. Again, this is David. We've been reading a lot of David in these last few weeks. David said this to the Lord. He gives the Lord an open door in his life. Lord, look everywhere, he says, and I quote from verse 23 of Psalm 139. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. Isn't that simple and really wonderfully profound? Lord, here's the open door. I'm yours, but I'm messed up. I'm not good, but I'm yours. So here I am. Here's all the cupboards and closets in my soul I open to you. And test me. Help me. Isn't that a great thing? Man. The first spiritual reason for depression is sin. Just simple. All there is, that's all there is to it. Just, you know, confess it. Stop it. And give him free rein to show you what else you need to know. You know, pretty simple. But there's another reason for spiritual depression, and it's dumb stuff we believe that the Bible did not teach us, that we just picked up along the way. And Elijah's part here, Elijah's life, he believed that he was the only one left and that the whole nation was going to hell in a handbasket, okay, as different members of my family say, you know. We just went through a difficult election. And the new administration is scary in a lot of the things that they believe and a lot of the agendas they're pushing. It's very easy right now to fall into a false kind of feeling that you're the only one that's still walking with Jesus, because there are millions upon millions of believers in this place who follow Jesus. And Elijah, you know, Lord, I'm it. There's none left. And, you know, at the end of this chapter of 1 Kings chapter 19, one thing the Lord says, he gets Elijah all the way through the physical reasons for depression and then into the discussion about his spiritual depression and gives him this. The Lord says, yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal, the false god, awful cult, anyhow, and those whose mouths have not kissed him. You're not the only one. You're not the, as I said a couple weeks ago, you're not the Lone Ranger. And if you will take care of yourself physically, and if you'll examine yourself spiritually with God's help, then you can face the things that you believe that are wacky. We can say that, right? Wacky beliefs that you're the only one walking with God. That's not true. You're not alone. And this is not a lost cause. So I want to encourage you today. If you've been down because of all the stuff we've been through in the last year, and then depending on what side of the political sides you are on, you know, that can be really depressing too. So I want you to consider this. Ask God for help with this depression and work through these simple things. Make sure you're taking care of yourself and you're eating right and that you're getting rest and you're getting exercise and that you're looking into God's word. The way to get over this, simply talk to him. Don't keep this inside. Don't keep this bottled up. Talk to him. Like the psalmist did in Psalm 139. Search me, Lord. Open your heart to him. Tell him how you feel. Ask him for his help. Include him in this process. Whenever you feel that you have failed him, that's when we withdraw and think we have to somehow figure this out on our own. No, our job is to just tell the truth and to trust his help. Well, God bless you this week. Hang in there, okay? And we'll talk next week. God bless you. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word, this wonderful story from Elijah's life, and for the lessons that we learned from it. And I ask for my friend here that you'll help them this week as they struggle through a dark time in their life. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for loving us so much that you came here to this world and became a human and walked in our shoes in this broken place, and then took the whole mess on yourself, Jesus, when you died on a cross for this cursed world and for our sins. We're grateful to you. Father, flood our lives. Help us. We'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Hang in there till next week. I'll see you. Bye-bye. Thank you for listening. If you would like to support Community Bible Church, we would appreciate your prayers and gifts. We can be reached at Community Bible Church 1888 Crescent Lake Road, Waterford, Michigan, 48327, or at our website, www.cbcmi.com. We'd appreciate your gifts. We know that many can't give right now. So if you would, you'd be a great blessing to your brothers and sisters. God bless you. Have a great day.